Welcome to topic 4, cryptocurrency and initial coin offerings. Cryptocurrency is a type of token, and initial coin offerings, or ICOs in short, are the processes through which crypto developers raise funds to support their new crypto projects or applications. In this module, we will learn about different types of tokens and get familiar with the different steps of the ICO process. What are crypto-based tokens or crypto tokens? Crypto tokens are fungible and tradable assets or utilities created over initial coin offerings, often found on blockchains. The crypto token world is fast evolving, and crypto developers are launching innovations every day. The tokens currently available in the crypto markets can be broadly clubbed into three categories: cryptocurrencies and commodities, utility, and security tokens. Cryptocurrencies are standard currencies used for making or receiving payments on the blockchain. In this sense, cryptocurrencies are not traditional currencies such as fiat currencies, which are issued by central banks and supported by governments. One of the most famous cryptocurrencies is Bitcoin. Altcoins, or alternative coins, are the alternative cryptocurrencies that were launched after the Bitcoin. Some notable examples of altcoins are Litecoin, Namecoin, and Dogecoin. Stablecoins are another type of cryptocurrencies that attempt to peg their market value to a fiat currency or commodities such as gold or silver. Fiat currencies are traditional currencies like United States dollar, European euro, which are actually issued by central banks and backed by governments. Some notable examples of fiat-based stable coins are Tether and True USD. Some stable coins not only peg their market value to a fiat currency, but also back it through a reserve of crypto assets. A notable example of crypto assets backed stable coin is MakerDAO's DAI. While DAI is pegged to the USD, it is backed by a basket reserve of crypto assets. Stable coins backed by crypto assets and pegged against a fiat currency can use two mechanisms to stabilize their prices. First, since stable coins are backed by a reserve of crypto assets, they might be able to avoid wide swings in the market. Second, stable coin issuers may jump in and manage the process by balancing the supply of the cryptocurrencies against their demands. Some other types of stable coins are not backed by any assets and use algorithms to manage their supply vis-a-vis their demand to stabilize the prices. One notable example of such stable coin is dollar-pegged base coin that uses consensus mechanisms to increase or decrease the supply of tokens. When we say consensus mechanisms, they allow network participants to create consensus on whether more currency should be released in the market or the supply of currencies should be restricted. Coming to crypto commodities. Crypto commodities are tradable or fungible assets that represent a commodity, utility, or a contract in the real or the virtual world. Ethereum is a prime example of a smart contract-based crypto commodity system. Although Ethereum works as a blockchain network and has its own currency token called Ether, in short referred to as ETH, it offers a lot more functionality than Bitcoins. On Ethereum, one can create digitized assets that can represent any service, utility, or a real or virtual world commodity. And one can even create his or her own cryptocurrencies, which are easily tradable and can have valuations independent from ETH. Now coming to utility tokens. Utility tokens are kind of user tokens. These are tokens that are given out during crowd sales as a project executes an ICO or initial coin offering. When a firm creates a utility token, it means that it is creating a form of a digital coupon that can be redeemed in the future for discounted fees or special access to a product or service. Utility tokens again can be of several types. First, they can be governance tokens that offer a say on the consensus protocol, products or services, as well as the future strategy of a crypto-based firm. A notable example is the DMM governance token, DeFi. Second, there can be discount tokens that offer a discounted fee to access the service. One of the most well-known examples of discount tokens is Binance, which currently gives a 50% discount on trading fees when those fees are paid with the BNB token. Third, there can be work tokens that allow validation and mining of the peer-to-peer transactions and require a stake in the native token. Work tokens are being utilized to develop proof-of-stake validation systems. Security tokens are tokens that equate to an ownership or debt stake in a company. These tokens are regulated by light securities regulations and thus can only be issued through an approved exchange or platform. We will talk about security tokens separately in the next module. Now we will move on to understand ICO processes. In short, ICO processes or initial coin offering processes connotes to the creation of a new cryptocurrency on a protocol such as Counterparty, Ethereum, or OpenLedger. It is imperative to note here that Counterparty, Ethereum, or OpenLedger are sometimes referred to as core blockchain technologies that can be used by service developers to develop their service offerings. The startup team behind the ICO arbitrarily determines the initial value of the cryptocurrency. The valuation is based on what the ICO startup team thinks the network is worth or would be worth in future. Once the ICO is launched, its price is determined by market supply and demand, and the value is settled on by the network of participants. One important aspect with respect to the ICOs is to understand why most of the ICOs are not regulated. While regulators across the globe, such as the Securities Exchange Commission in the USA, are looking forward to taming the ICO market, many ICOs remain unregulated because of two important aspects. First, most ICOs don't actually offer equity or debt in startup ventures. Instead, they offer discounts on cryptocurrencies before they hit the exchange. Therefore, tokens offered through ICOs don't fit into the current definition of security and are technically outside of traditional legal frameworks. Second, ICOs are global instruments, not national ones, and are funded using Bitcoin, Ether, and other cryptocurrencies that are not fiat currencies and are not controlled by any central authority or banks. Currently, there's no anti-money laundering law or Know Your Customer framework for crypto assets and crypto tokens. It is important to note here that while ICOs are not regulated, many anti-money laundering authorities are using technology to monitor transactions on popular crypto platforms such as Bitcoin. Finally, in this module, we will learn about different stages in launching an ICO. We could categorize the ICO launching process into 7 steps, as shown on the slide. These steps cover different aspects, from conception to final offering of the ICO. The first step in launching an ICO is to get familiar with the crypto industry using local forums, virtual forums, as well as crypto conferences. These venues could also be useful in recruiting like-minded people as teammates. Once a team is formed, the second most important task is to brainstorm ideas and write down a draft of a white paper. The white paper elaborates in detail the business model, team, and functioning of the future project. At this juncture, it is very essential to get formal and informal advice from technical, legal, marketing, and business advisors who have experience with the launch of ICOs. Once the idea matures, the third step is to publish the white paper in the public domain, along with a website detailing useful information about your idea, advisors, and team members. In short, all legal, technical, and organizational issues should be appropriately addressed in the white paper. It is also important to talk to regulators to understand the regulatory implications of the proposed ICO. In Finland, the Financial Supervisory Authority offers innovation help services that can assist entrepreneurs in understanding the regulatory implications of their proposed projects. The fourth most crucial step is public relations drive. During the launch of the white paper, or even before the launch of the white paper, the team should promote its ideas in the crypto and other relevant markets using forums and conferences. These channels could also be used to gauge interest and collect feedback from the crypto community, traditional investors such as business angels and private equities, as well as potential retail investors. The feedback could be used to set targets and timelines for raising funds. At this juncture, it is also important to talk to and start negotiation with exchanges where crypto tokens might be listed. The fifth step is to launch the digital wallets and other necessary infrastructure, where buyers could send the cryptocurrency and are issued a smart contract. During this stage, it is very important to finalize negotiations with exchanges for the listing of crypto tokens. As a sixth step, the team should finalize its project and carry out a thorough digital, technical, and legal due diligence before launching. Finally, the token project should be listed on the selected exchange. It is important to keep monitoring the code for potential security errors and fix them not only before listing, but also after the listing. While detailing different steps of an ICO process, I would like to warn the course participants that reality could not be categorized into simplified processual steps. The actual project launch will be messy. And actually, it is very important to consult experts and form team members before launching an ICO.